Shalom from Jerusalem. This is Watchmen Talk, a series of conversations with Israeli military, intelligence, diplomatic and security experts and practitioners. And we are very pleased and honored to host retired Major General Yair Golan, the former Vice Chief of Staff of the Israeli military, as well as the holder of many other important positions. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for inviting me.
You know, General, this is the land of prophets, but also of prophets without honor. People whose prophecies were eventually found to be on the money. However, they themselves were not honored for it. And on several occasions, this is what happened to you. Most recently politically, but this is not the focus of our conversations. And the question is, does the Israeli military teach you to be a very respectful officer to your superiors, to voice your opinions, but only in-house, not be too voluble about them, especially not outside to the media or to the Knesset. When a young officer looks at you and sees that you were right most of the time in your predictions and warnings and suffered from it, what lesson should this officer get from it?
Hopefully, speak up. Speak up. You have a voice, and your voice is important, and no one, truly no one, has this attribute to think better than you.
And the higher ups, they know better. They have more.
I know. You know, when I was conscripted in 1980, yes, I look at the higher echelons as kind of, you know,
demigods.
They cannot make a mistake, but this is so untrue. People are people are people, and even the higher echelons, they do terrible mistakes, and therefore you need to take this historical lesson and speak up. If you explore an issue, if you have the right knowledge, if you have the right experience, if you are fully confident concerning what you are talking about, yes, speak up. Come on. You know, if you want a healthy system, you need people who wish to speak up and to express their thoughts about professional issues.
This is how you treated your junior officers or people subordinate?
All the time, all the time. I used to say to my subordinate officers that, look, you are not threatening me. I'm a well confident person, and I know myself, and I know from my experience that in many cases you are right and I'm wrong, and it's okay. It doesn't make me
it doesn't threaten you. Yeah,
exactly.
So in the Israeli system, in most militaries, the highest rank is a four-star general. Israel, as a poor country, at least used to be modest, only has one three-star general at any time. Yeah. This is the chief of staff. And all others are either two-star generals or one-star.
Yeah.
And in other militaries, a division commander is a two-star, a major general. In Israel, it's a brigadier general. So before an officer such as yourself, having fulfilled two important positions as division commander on the Lebanese border and in the West Bank, before you could have taken command of a territorial command, in your case, Northern Command, you had to undertake a more junior position in importance in the Israeli system, though not in rank, and this is home front command. Were you happy to take it?
It was fantastic.
What have you done with it?
I came to the home front command after the Second Lebanon War. The command was in a terrible situation, terrible condition, low morale. And for me, it was a great challenge. And it was about learning a new profession. And it was fantastic. You know, I used to say that in the first year and a half of my assignment, I learned something new every day. And since then, and till the end of my tenure, I learned something new every week. It's fantastic. It's so interesting.
The interface with the civilian world.
With civilians, with NBC warfare, with mayors, with the local government.
NBC, including nuclear, Israel prepared for a nuclear attack?
For everything. And I can tell you that for me, it was fascinating. I learned so many new things. And by the way, it allows me to be much more knowledgeable, you know, concerning civilian life, because I used to work with mayors, you know, how to prepare a city or town for a war, for a disaster, for natural disaster.
Food, water, transportation, infrastructure.
Everything. I visited any infrastructure location in Israel. How many people have in Israel such an experience?
But regardless of the effort that you and, and your officers and the whole command invested, the enemies know that this is Israel's soft underbelly, the vulnerability of the population, not only regarding casualties, but also that they will put pressure on the government to shorten the war before war aims have been achieved. How can you solve this problem?
In a way, I disagree with this notion. You know, I think Israeli citizens are absolutely supportive and cooperative with the government. And as long as they think that the government fulfills its missions, well, they are totally committed and they are willing to undertake all difficulties of war in a very patient manner. And this is unbelievable. The civilian population, in fact, is much stronger than we used to think about civilians. They are okay. They will give us whatever we need. All we need in the military is to fulfill our missions and to beat our enemies. That's the story.
Strangely enough, you are right. The Israeli society, at least through its media and other expressions, is more concerned with military casualties than with civilian casualties in the rear.
Unbelievable, because it's about our kids. The soldiers are our kids.
Because it's universal military training, not universal, because many people, especially Haredim, do not.
There are so many Israelis that have this military experience, and they tell themselves, you know, as civilians, all right, I know that I can stand, you know, these civilian difficulties, but what is really bother me is the destiny of my son or my daughter, and this is the issue.
Now, the Home Front Command was set up after 1991 when Israel did not take active part in the Iraq War, but was on the receiving end of missiles from Iraq. And the original intention was to grow the command and then transfer it to the police or another agency. What's your view?
Well, it's a mistakeful thinking about the Home Front Command. No other organization but the military is willing to or have the capability to deal with emergencies. There is the basic idea is that the most fitted organization in the nation is the one who is responsible for massive emergencies. This is the military. That's true for Israel, that's true for the National Guard in the United States, that's true for Switzerland or Germany on the UK. It doesn't matter. No other organization could do it better. Therefore, the military is also responsible for natural disasters. And when I visited Japan after the Fukushima affair, after the tsunami, the one who really handled the business there in the most, you know, devastated areas was the Japanese military. When I entered China after the earthquake of 2008, the one who really handled the situation there was the military.
You also sent aid and rescue missions abroad when natural disasters hit many places around the globe.
Yes, and you see that no other organization couldn't handle, you know, a massive, you know, group of, you know, a medical group with rescue teams without this military organization, because you need people to be very
dedicated
with a very mission-like approach, which is the military approach.
So the Air Force flies you there. Yeah. The engineers know how to dig from under. Even working military dogs, which Israel employs, help. And during your tenure as home front commander, Iron Dome starting having its amazing success. Again, the joint work between the Air Force in early warning and in air defense and the home front command is one of the hallmarks of the Israeli military.
That's true. It was very tough at the beginning because the Air Force didn't want to cooperate. And we told them, look, we need to work together. You know, what are you going to do with all the intelligence and knowledge?
What was their rationale? Why not share it?
Because, you know, we have our own
shop,
core, and we are close, and what we are doing is classified, and we have no intention to expose it to the civilians. But I think that I managed to convince them that it's okay. We need to work together. There's no other way. And the minute they understood it, they did it fantastically. You know, it was just a true friendship between home front command and the Air Force in an unbelievable way.
The Air Force commanding general in part of your period, Major General Amir Eshel, then turned around and started to warn the population not to expect such a high rate of intercepts the next time around, because it was too good to be true. And if Israel is hit by barrages or swarms, the intercept missiles may not be enough.
It's never enough. And I think we need to prepare the population like they don't have Iron Dome. And we need to train local governments, municipalities, for deal with the greatest challenge they could imagine during war. And I think this is the right way to prepare the Israeli home front.
But you know, we are not
You need to deal with true emergencies, and you cannot rely on, you know, Iron Dome and say, all right, I don't have to prepare because I have this, you know, Iron Dome above me. It doesn't true.
But we're not dealing with generic people or with teaching home front 101, because these are Israelis.
Yes.
Of a certain character and attitude. David Ben-Gurion, the founding father of Israel, later to become prime minister and defense minister, emulating Winston Churchill's model in Britain in World War II, was in London during the Blitz.
Yeah.
And he saw the British people, stiff upper lip and all of that, stay calm and carry on, all the cliches. And he feared that the Israelis will not behave in the same manner. Are you assured or reassured that when an emergency of huge proportions strikes, Israelis will know how to behave, to follow the rules.
Yeah. You need to trust the people in order to get their trust. You know, there is no other way. No other way.
It's
trust for trust. And if you want them to be with stamina, with you know, this ability to stand for and carry on, you need to believe that they could do it, and you need to train them, and we need to trust them. And I never ever got disappointed by civilians I trained.
Now, you were in charge of Northern Command. Most of the recent chiefs of staff of the Israeli military came from Northern Command as their general officer position. We see now going back General Kochavi, General Eisenkot, General Gantz, General Ashkenazi, most of the recent ones. And originally, this was after the peace with Egypt. This was the most coveted position for a general, because if war were to come, it will be with Syria, and if not, with Hezbollah in Lebanon. Yeah. But during your time, in the last decades, Syria was undergoing a civil war, and Hassan Nasrallah, the leader of Hezbollah, was apparently deterred. What were your priorities as you headed Northern Command?
Well, training for fighting the Hezbollah, that's for sure. I could say that without the civil war in Syria, Hezbollah tried to warm up the Lebanese front in 2012. But the minute Rouhani put a pressure on Nasrallah to be more involved in the civil war in Syria, they turned their mind to the Syrian front, and they start to send the, you know, thousands of people from the Hezbollah to help the Assad regime to cope with the rebellion.
And gained much valuable experience by doing that.
Yes, yes, that's true. But I would say that, you know, I trained, I prepared the Northern Command fighting Hezbollah, and at the same time, I was truly focused on the civil war in Syria in order to create the most, supportive condition along the border in such an unstable situation. And I think I'm very proud by the fact that we were managed to get cooperation from Syrians group along the border for many years. And at the same time, we did the right moral issue to treat the casualties in a saving life manner. And therefore, I think we did well along the Lebanese border and at the same time along the Syrian border.
It is now public domain that during that time, then Prime Minister Netanyahu and then Defense Minister Barak ordered the military to prepare for action against Iran. Many people in the higher command were not for it. Of course, they would have saluted and obeyed. Your predecessor at Northern Command, General Eisenkot, at one time wrote the Prime Minister and Defense Minister that although this is not his sector, obviously the Northern Command will be impacted by it, and he wanted to be on record as opposing it or objecting to it, dissenting from it. What was your position, and do you think that the Northern Front would have erupted had Israel acted against Iran at that time?
Well, I think that General Eisenkot was right. I commanded at that time the Home Front Command, and I thought the same, that we should not attack Iran. Not because we cannot do it, because you know how you started, you have no clue how to finish such a war. And I was not sure at that time that it's so, you know, it's so, you know, it's not... It's
crucial.
It's not crucial. We didn't reach at that time a decisive point in time that we must do it. So therefore, I think if the risk is so high, the need for international support and mainly American support is crucial. And therefore, you know, just doing, you know, independently and attacking Iran, I thought at that time that this is irrational attitude toward the challenge we have in Iran. And I the first to admit that Iran is a true and a unique challenge for Israel.
Now, this debate reached its peak between 2010 and 2012, and then as President Obama started his negotiations first secretly in Oman, and then openly with other parties in Vienna, you, as a vice chief of staff already, you step up from Northern Command, firstly saw the JCPOA, the nuclear deal, being formulated. And as vice chief of staff in charge of both force buildup and operational planning, you were actually heading the Iran file. What was your position when there was a debate, which Netanyahu, of course, was the public figure of one school of thought, going to Congress against Obama's wishes, operating against the deal, and others thought that while an imperfect deal, it is preferable to no deal. What was your position?
Well, you know, in a way, it's also a political issue, not just, you know, professional issue. But I would say that all of us, not just myself, all of us, all the high-rank officers, the guys from the Mossad and other agencies, we all thought that the agreement is imperfect, but at the same time is good for Israel. It's much better than anything else. And therefore, we thought that we need to take all advantages out of this agreement, and at the same time, working with the Americans to shape the next agreement. The next agreement. Because the agreement, in fact, cover a period of 10 to 15 years.
And had sunset clauses.
Yeah. And we thought that, all right, let's take all advantages out of this agreement. And then, you know, at working with the Americans, not waiting for, you know, 10 years from now, 15 years from now. No. Immediately. Working with the Americans, how to shape the next deal in the most favorable manner for Israel.
But this is one level. The other level is that if the threat is being put off for several years, it frees money and time for focusing on other priorities which the IDF had.
Exactly.
And get some compensation package from the Americans.
Everything is true. And I would say the following. For Israel, to fight Iran alone, more than 1,000 kilometers to the east, it's almost impossible. We are not a superpower. We need to understand our limitations.
And it will not be a single strike like in Syria in 2007 or Iraq, 1981.
Certainly not. And therefore, you know, to conduct a kind of attrition war with Iran, along such a distance, well, you need to have the American with you. And you need to work with them in order to prepare such an operation. And I can tell you that as a vice chief of staff, I work intensively with my American counterparts in order to establish something operationally. And I think we move forward in a very good manner. Unfortunately, I think that Netanyahu, by his attitude, was a kind of obstacle concerning our ability to move forward with the American military establishment.
Because the political echelon of the Obama administration...
They just stop everything. In a certain point, my counterparts told me, look, General, we like you very much. And we like to, you know, to talk, you know, this, to have these Iranian talks with you, but this is not our policy right now.
In the slightly more than a minute that we have, two unfair questions, but because you are used to speak up, you're the right person to ask them. First of all, you were passed over for Chief of Staff for Ramatkal, for reasons which were not related to your professional standing. What would you have done had you been the Chief of Staff 7 to 3 years ago?
I think that we need to concentrate our efforts in order to have a decisive land forces. And I'm not so sure whether we prepare the land forces in the right manner. I think that next war will be determined, the outcome of the war will be determined on land. It's not new. It's actually like, you know, it's like going back to old
biblical times.
Yeah. But it's about the land.
Okay.
And we need to be there in a much better prepared land forces.
Last question. You went into politics, other generals went into politics. Are you really made up for politics, or does your experience tell you that this is a totally different profession?
Amir, I follow my heart. And my heart is in the politics right now because I want to influence the destiny of Israel as the homeland of the Jewish people and at the same time, democratic, free, and equal state. So
Major General,
this is my mission.
Major General retired Yair Golan from home front to homeland. Thank you very much for two very, very thought-provoking conversations. This has been Watchmen Talk on TV7 News. For the time being, shalom from Jerusalem.